spirit break out. Heaven come down. Spirit break out. Break our walls down. Spirit.
Amen. Well, welcome home, church. It's great to be here at home with you, gathered together in God's house as we gather to hear God's word, to be met by him, and then to return praise to him as we gather together. For any guests that are with us here today, we are so blessed to have you here with us. And if you're a first-time guest, we especially want to say thank you for being here with us. So we have a special gift for you at our Welcome Center out in the fellowship area that you can pick up after our worship service. And if you don't know exactly where that is, just ask someone around you. I'm sure they'd be glad to direct you to the right place. Well, today as we gather together in God's house, we're going to be starting a new sermon series on love. And how fitting as we come this week up to Valentine's Day, right? That day that we celebrate this idea of love. But Pastor Doug is going to be starting this off here for us today, giving us an idea, reminding us of what true love is and how we see that in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Before we get into that, let's take a look at what's going on this week here at St. Paul's with our weekly blueprint.
Welcome home, church. It's wonderful to connect with you here in worship. We gather ready to act as we remember all that God has done and his promises for us. At St. Paul's, it is our mission to build the home and change the world. So let's continue to build up our homes and others around us by deepening our commitment to our relationship with Christ and engaging in his great plan for us. Here is your weekly blueprint.
Build the home, change the world. This is our mission at St. Paul's. What better way to see it in action than through our Mission Guatemala experience, where we literally build homes while also laying strong foundations for families through the love of Christ. who changed the world for the people of Los Limones, Guatemala, through this important work. Here at St. Paul's, you can be a part of this kingdom work in two ways. First, there is still time for you to be a part of our Mission Guatemala team for 2017. Our team will complete this work in two groups, traveling June 3rd through 10th and September 23rd through 30th. We will build homes, beds, stoves, and lead vacation Bible school for children, serving as the hands and feet of Jesus. The other way for you to be a vital part of this work is through your financial support. Each piece of this project requires proper building materials. It takes 700 blocks just to build one house. With two houses to build, we need twice as many supplies. For as little as $7, you can provide one building block for a home that will grace flip the lives of a family in Los Limones. There are additional opportunities for you to support the building of beds and stoves, as well as supplying the materials and snacks needed for a VBS for the children. You may also choose to sponsor a mission team member. If you feel led to participate in this important work in either way, please visit our table in the fellowship area for more information.
Many in our family of faith and in our community have been impacted by illness or are struggling with other challenges in their lives. But even in these hard places, God is still with us, and He's moving powerfully in our midst. Here at St. Paul's, we're dedicated to advancing Jesus' ministry of healing by lifting up in prayer all those in need of healing and by teaching and sharing His powerful message. We welcome all who are in need of healing or who desire to lift up others in need during Worship, Pray, Receive, a service of healing here on Friday, February 17th at 7 p.m. Pastor Eric Trickey and our Praise Team Ministry will lead us in an evening of worship and prayer here in our sanctuary. Come, welcome others, and receive the abundance of the Father's love for you. We invite you to be a part of God's great plan for your home and family through these opportunities. If you need more information, you can always refer to your worship guide or connect with us online at spldecatur.org. If you need assistance or have questions while you're with us, our ushers are ready to help you right here in our sanctuary. Or visit our Welcome Center. Our team is glad to serve. Now, with one heart and mind, let's get on our feet, church, and get ready to worship. It's time to greet and welcome one another.
Good morning. Good morning. Now, are you saying good night, good evening? Good morning. Good morning. It's great to see all of you in worship this morning. We're excited to worship with you once again. This week, as Pastor Mark mentioned, we are really embracing the month of February, kind of the love month, with a sermon series all about love. So we come together to worship and to express our adoration of a more than deserving God. So we begin our worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. He makes us new every time, every day. His mercies are new for us. Let's worship Him together.
You're taking me deeper.
Take a moment in the Word, and so I would invite everyone to take out your Bible. You can grab a pew Bible in front of you and open it to page 959, or you can follow on the screen, but I love it when I have that Word right in my hands. We'll be reading this together this morning. The very common words that we often hear when we're referring to what God has to say about love and how we need to act in love from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Let's read this together from this version. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we need you to teach us once again how to live this life to honor you, to truly be people who show love in all circumstances. Lord, convict us by your word. Use Pastor Doug this this morning. Empower him through your Spirit to teach us once again how to live more fully for you so that we can have truly an abundant life in Christ. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you today from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. We are diving into a new short series starting this weekend on that topic of love. In just a few short days, people all around us will be celebrating the idea of love on Valentine's Day. And this is a day, at least to me, and when I'm being my most pessimistic, seems to be a day that is so manufactured at times, bought and sold in the forms of cards, roses, chocolates, heart-shaped pizzas. A day when men raise their voices in one saying, oh, what am I getting for her again? Or you may choose to rebel completely against this holiday and create your own celebration like National Singles Awareness Day. The acronym is SAD, by the way. No matter how you or others feel about this holiday, it does bring that idea of love to mind. And what a better time for us as God's people to think on how God has loved us and calls us to love one another. The things that we as Christians should always be doing every single day of our lives. Now, no one is going to argue with you that love is a good thing. That is pretty much universally accepted, but there are a lot of different ideas out there in our world about just what love is. There's love at first sight, or finding the right person, the soulmate. It's that spark. You can't really define love. You feel love. Love is supposed to come easy. It's something you just know to be true deep within yourself. It's a euphoric rocket ship to the moon fueled by Twitter passion. It feels so right, and it's never supposed to let you down. But what happens when it does? What happens when that love that felt so right and that spark that was there seems to just fade away? What happens when the ship crash lands and that person you thought was so perfect inevitably lets you down? What happens when easy turns to hard and struggles and conflicts come up in friendships and marriages and it just seems to be insurmountable? What does love look like in those places? Well, friends in Christ, God's definition of love is the very answer to that. God's definition of love is the playing out of that very scenario. Everything we have in that book sitting in the pew in front of you, God's word, Holy Scripture, comes together to make the greatest love story that's ever been told. It's the story about a creator who made people perfect for him and perfect for one another. But conflicts sprang up. Inevitably, they chose sin and became a disappointment to the creator. And those conflicts seemed insurmountable. There was jealousy and murder, arrogance, fear, and rage. The creator watched as his handiwork began to fade away, and the relationships seemed lost forever. So God decided to show this world what true love is all about when love meets imperfection. It was a love that was bigger than that moment of life in the Garden of Eden. It would flow out from the garden. It was a love that started and ended with action as the Creator himself promised to provide a way through his Son Jesus as a way out of our mess. And it was a love that did the hard thing as Jesus restricted himself, gave himself up so that every one of us could know and be empowered to have what this kind of love is all about, so that we could experience it and live in it for the rest of our lives. Now, God did all of this for us. This was all for our benefit. So maybe we should let him steer the ship when it comes to understanding his idea of love and this powerful force that is at work in and around us. If you look in your bulletins this morning, you'll notice I have headers in the notes section for the different aspects of God's love as defined by Scripture. And I'd like to spend the rest of our time here this morning going over three different aspects of God's love. The first aspect of God's love is that it's more than just a moment. God's love is bigger than any one moment. Listen to this. The average cost of a wedding in the United States is $26,645. $26,645. Now that is no small amount of money. Maybe you're thinking to yourself, I didn't spend anything near that. That's got to be skewed by like celebrity weddings. Somebody is pumping that way up. And maybe you're right. But I want you to think about this morning. How does what you spent on your wedding day compare to what you're spending on your marriage? Does the time and the energy and the resources that we put into making this beautiful and picture-perfect moment, does that measure up to the time and the energy and the resources of what we're doing in a relationship actively and intentionally in an ongoing fashion? Now, brides past and brides-to-be, please hear me on this. Don't hear what I'm not saying. I am not saying that you shouldn't have a beautiful moment to celebrate with all your family and friends. Pastor Doug is not about to take that away from you. But perhaps God is calling us to a kind of love that shows that level of care and intentionality in all those simple, ordinary moments that would come after that day and days like that. One of the greatest descriptions of God's love is what we just read together from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This is the great love chapter of the Bible, and Paul writes this. I'll reread a few of those verses. Paul says, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. As I read through this list of the qualities of God's love, it strikes me. All of these characteristics require constant, enduring effort. We don't just muster up enough patience and kindness and humility in order to get through a dating phase or a friendship startup or to speak some wedding vows to each other. It's more than just these beautiful, picture-perfect moments. You are entering into a lifetime of practicing these virtues. Now, I have been to so many weddings, and I've officiated a few weddings so far where we get to listen to this scripture, and we're all thinking these lighthearted and happy thoughts as we watch a husband take his bride in his arms, and we can just see in his eyes as he's hearing this scripture and he's looking at his bride-to-be, and he's thinking to himself, yes, this is love. This is majestic marital love. But look at this list that you're committing to. Patience, kindness, no envy, no boasting, no pride, honoring all others, selfless, slow to anger, never keeps a scorecard, hates evil, even though evil is fun, and always, always, always protects, trusts, hopes, and endures. That is hard stuff. This is a two steps forward, 10 back kind of love. This takes a lifetime of striving and learning, of repenting and forgiving, and we will never, ever fully arrive. I have to be honest with you. This is confession time. I am horrible at showing this kind of love. You put my name in these verses, and it would be more accurate to describe me most of the time with the opposite characteristics. Doug isn't patient. He gets frustrated when we don't leave on time. Doug is rude, especially when he's hungry. Doug brags about frivolous things. Doug gets caught up in self-preservation all the time. Doug questions people's motives. Doug keeps a record, and he knows who unloaded the dishwasher the last time, and hint, hint, it wasn't you. As Christians, we have got to get real about God's kind of love. This love is not easy. And this love does not come naturally to us. This love is selfless and sacrificial. It's everything deep down that we really don't want to be. We have got to get ourselves out of the way of this kind of love. We've got a sinful flesh, a DNA inside us that fights against this. If you want this kind of love, you are going to struggle to practice it. But God's love sticks around when the honeymoon is over. God's love offers the most meaningful experience and purpose for this life. And even though all these traits are not easy for us to demonstrate, they do take work and we make slow progress in them. When we do start to grow in these godly characteristics, they lead to a life and to relationships that are so much easier down the road and are filled with so much more peace once we begin to understand and practice them. Because people stop becoming our problems. And we start tackling sin together as godly husbands and wives, as friends, and as a godly family. It's a love that can make all moments in life beautiful and extravagant, even and especially the simple and ordinary ones. Aspect number two for us this morning, God's kind of love is all about action. This means we have to learn to prioritize motion before emotion. We have to put motion before emotion. We have to be willing to act and to do rightly even before we might feel right about it. Pastor Ray summed this up perfectly the other day. He said, right feelings will follow right actions. God's love teaches us to do right before we feel right. This is the kind of love that was put on display in the story of Ruth, a great book of the Bible. Ruth's love story takes place during the time of the judges of Israel, and this was about 1,000 years before Christ was born. And in a time when everybody thought love was about doing what was right in their own eyes, here comes Ruth, this Moabite woman, and she shows up as an outsider to Israel, and she gets grafted into a community and puts on a love that displays faithfulness and commitment, even when the blessing and the reward of that commitment seem so far away. We hear this in Ruth chapter 1. I read for you, starting in verse 1. In the days when the judges ruled over the people, there was a famine in the land. And a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth. They lived there about 10 years, and both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and without her husband. Now, the book of Ruth might have one of the most tragic starts to any book of the Bible. It's right up there with the book of Job. A faithful Israelite man, Elimelech, picks up his wife and his two sons and moves to Moab so that they can just survive this famine that's taking place in Israel. And this is where his two sons meet two young women, Orpah and Ruth. And after about 10 years with no children in the picture, all the men in the family are dead. For these women, you have to understand, that meant no certain hope and no certain future. At this point, Naomi is begging her daughters-in-law to go home. They weep together, and Orpah turns back to go back to Moab. But not Ruth. Ruth clung to Naomi. This widow looked at her mother-in-law, and she said this to her. Ruth says to Naomi, "Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. And may the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you." Do you hear the echoes? The echoes of wedding vows in these words. These are covenant words, commitment words. There was no compelling reason for Ruth to stay with Naomi. She probably didn't feel like it. And culturally speaking, she was free to go home, and nobody would have argued with that. But she was a woman clothed in strength and dignity. She chose motion before emotion. It was a hard place to stay, and there was mourning and there was sadness. Orpah turned back, but not Ruth. She chose to bind herself to her new family, even without her husband. Ruth loved Naomi, and she chose to demonstrate her character in the middle of an impossible situation, and later on down the road, that would carry over into an amazing love story that God was still writing for her. Fast forward in the story of Ruth, and God would lead her to meet this man named Boaz, and this was one of Naomi's relatives, and that's very important, because it meant that he could be a kinsman redeemer. He could buy her back and save the family name. Boaz heard about Ruth's character. And a long story short, Boaz kind of had a thing for her. So when Boaz finally gets the chance to speak to Ruth, he tells her this. Boaz says to Ruth, "All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has fully been told to me. And how you left your father and your mother and your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. The Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge." You see, Boaz saw the choices that Ruth had made, and he was blown away. He saw the way that her love meant faithfulness and perseverance because of her actions. He was so overcome by this that he ended up taking her to be his wife, redeeming her honor and her name. And that Moabite girl, Ruth, and her unlikely newfound husband, Boaz, would have a child that led to the very lineage of King David and ultimately to King Jesus himself. You know, I think we've bought into a terrible lie about love in our world today. That somehow we can do whatever we want. We can be with whomever we want and do with them whatever we please. But later on down the life, then I'll start to try and understand what it means to be a faithful person. Later on, I'll assume some more responsibility for my life, but not right now, not right here. I'm too young. There's too much life for me to live. But I've got news for you. Who you are right now, that matters. And who you are is who you'll attract. Jesus said that all people would know his followers. They would know us by our love. What kind of love are we putting on display? When people look at you, they don't see the future version of you that you hope to one day become. They see the kind of love and the life that you are leading right here and now. Are you longing for a friend or for a spouse to love you with respect and gentleness and faithfulness? You have got to start practicing. We have got to be that person so that God can one day raise up someone who sees you and sees that in you and values you for it and is drawn to you because of it. Finally, our third aspect of God's love is that God calls us to restrict ourselves in order to empower others. Love is restricting yourself to empower others. This is the pathway of Christ. Jesus said in John chapter 15, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends." Love is doing what Christ did for us. And that means that love is a series of self-sacrifices. It began first with the work of Jesus for us, a life poured out from the cross so that we could have this love, so that we could be filled to the brim with God's love. And as it's poured out into us, we in turn pour it out into the lives of all those around us, our families and our neighbors, whoever it is that God is putting in our path. This is the single mom and single dad working multiple jobs, doing the best they can to raise their children and to give them a hope and a future. This is the son or the daughter who's caring for their aging parent whose body and mind is slipping away. This is the coworker who reaches out, goes out of their way to connect with other people in the office or in the shop when life seems to be stacking up against them. God's love might even mean that those big dreams you've had for yourself, they could be reworked. They could even be overhauled by God if it's his will. Christ was anxious to take on what the Father had in store for him. Jesus prayed himself in the garden that it could be altered or taken away, but he prayed, "Not my will, Father, but yours be done." And I'll tell you what, it was love that compelled Jesus to do what God was setting before him. It was love for you and love for me that restricted Jesus to that cross. You were his joy, and he became your salvation. Love is willing to do that, to give up yourself, if it means giving more to another. I saw a difficult but glorious picture of love this past week. It happened in a hospital room on the fourth floor of DMH. You might remember, not too long ago, we brought in a huge host of people in our new member welcome. In our last basics class, we had people that stood from this end of the steps all the way to that end. It was a huge group that we welcomed into God's family here. And among those people were a couple, Craig and Cindy Tapperson. Craig came forward in a wheelchair, and I got the privilege, he stood right down here, I got the privilege of shaking his hand after we welcomed them and they spoke their vows to be members here just this past December. They have a son, Dan, and he's been members of this church for a while now. Not too long ago, Craig had to go in for a surgery. In the operation, it fixed what was wrong, but there were complications from that surgery. Craig's lungs were filling with fluid, and they started to lose their function. Craig struggled to draw every single breath that he took, and he was in tremendous amounts of pain. His condition grew worse, and things weren't looking good. Craig was so scared, but he was becoming more and more tired in that fight. Finally, he made the decision, I can't do this anymore. I can't keep fighting this way. I want to be taken off the ventilators. This past Tuesday morning, I watched as his wife and his son took his hand and they spoke to him words of comfort. We listened as Craig confessed his sins and need for a Savior. And his son Dan came over and said to Craig that he would be there to take care of mom. He would do whatever it takes. And dad, you can go to be with Jesus. It's okay now. We prayed together. And I leaned over. And in that moment, I told Craig, I want you to know, Craig, there is so much love in this room right now. Nobody wanted to be there. Not Craig, not Cindy, not Dan, not anyone. But in that room, it was God's love that was holding everyone and everything together. It was the kind of love that said, I'm not going anywhere, and not even death is going to separate us. This is true love. It's not airbrushed. It's not easy. But when it shows up in our lives, it binds us together in perfect harmony, though the world around us rages on. This is the love that flows out into all moments. It moves us to action. It decreases ourselves so that we can increase others. It's the love we try at and we fail at. But it's the love that picks us back up and says, you can do it because you are forgiven. Go back out into this world and love people to Jesus. It is why we are here as God's people. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. And God says, the greatest of these is love. In the name of love incarnate, in Jesus' name, amen. Now may the peace that passes all understanding guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto that life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Doug. What a wonderful message to remind us of what love truly is. As we see God's great love for us, he calls us then to respond in love back to him. And it is seeing God's love that we then enter into this time of worship, this response of love to God as we give back to him what is but his own, in as we worship him with the giving of our offerings. And as we do this, I want to remind you that there are worship cards in the pews in front of you, both for our members and for guests. If you would fill one of those out and pass them toward the center aisles, our ushers will pick those up as they come back through. Now we worship the Lord with the giving of our offerings.
You see of the future.
God's great love for us, we are bold to come before him as his children and to bring before him, confessing our sins, laying them before him that we might receive what he has promised, his steadfast love and forgiveness. And so I invite you at this time to stand and join with me as we confess our sins and lay them before God our Father. Heavenly Father, your love is the only reason I'm standing here now. You have loved me with an everlasting love, called me to be your own. Your love made you give up the most precious thing you had, your only son, Jesus. As hard as it is to admit and think about, I've squandered that love so selfishly. I've settled for so much less than your idea of love. I've struggled with impatience, rudeness, envy, boasting, pride, selfishness, and so many other vices that stand in the way of your kind of love. Don't give me what I deserve. That would only end in death and eternal misery. Please give me what you've promised, a love that never fails. Forgive me for Jesus' sake, and help me to learn to love you and those you put in front of me more and more. In Jesus' name, amen. God's love for us is indeed never ending. It goes on, and we see that in our Lord and Savior Jesus. And Paul declares to us in Romans chapter 5 that God indeed shows his love to us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And so it is my privilege to stand here and declare to you today, your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, we remember Christ's love sacrifice for us on the cross as we come once again to receive him as he comes to us in his body and blood in the Lord's Supper. And so we remember on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Our Lord Jesus does truly come to us in this Lord's Supper through his body and blood. We receive him for our forgiveness. And if this is your true confession, I invite you now, come receive this precious gift of our Lord and Savior. Congregation may be seated, and I invite the helpers to come forward at this time.
I'd like to remind you also that if you would like to pray with someone during this time of communion, there will be prayer ministers available to pray with you. One will be over on the side towards the front and one in the back, and you can get up anytime and pray with them. Thank you.
Now may this true body and true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in his joy and peace. Amen. I invite you now to stand as we gather together as the body of Christ and lift up our prayers and petitions to our gracious and loving God. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are indeed love. And we see that most of all, Lord, in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who you sent to this world to live as one of us, to die, to rise again, that we might be brought to you. We see that love displayed in our Lord as he sacrificed himself for us. Lord, as you bring us into this love relationship, as you bring us into our family, Lord, help us to realize that you call us to respond in this same love, Lord. May you fill us with your love and with your Holy Spirit, that you might continue to help us and lead us to live lives showing your love. Lord, that we might show your love in our families, in our friends, in the midst of our coworkers, Lord, and throughout our life, that as you fill us up, it may flow out of us into every area. Lord, we thank and praise you for who you are and that you have drawn us to you, Lord. And Lord, we lift up and remember in our prayers today those our brothers and sisters in Christ who are in need of you, Lord, in need of your healing at this time. We lift up John Hostler, who is in the hospital. And Lord, we also lift up Mike Mize and Gary Waybright as they continue to recover from their illnesses. Lord, would you strengthen them as they wait for this recovery, Lord, as they wait for your healing. Give them patience as well, Lord. Place your healing hand on them. And Lord, be with Kurt Perkins as he goes into surgery this week, that you may bless him through this surgery, that you would guide the doctors and medical staff, that all this may be a blessing and to his benefit as well. And Lord, we do want to lift up to you the family of Craig Tapperson, Lord, as they continue to mourn their loss. And Lord, we pray that you would wrap your loving arms around them, that you would be in the midst of them, Lord, reminding them of your great love for them, that you would instill in them the hope and comfort of their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord, help us as their brothers and sisters in Christ, their faith family here at St. Paul's, to continue to come around them in the weeks and months to come, Lord, realizing that the hurt, the loss of a loved one doesn't just go away after a week, Lord, but that it continues for weeks and months and years to come. Then you would help us to continue to bring comfort to them in your love, that they may feel that in a tangible and real way. Lord, continue to wrap your arms around this family. And Lord, we pray that you would continue to bring more and more people to know you in our community here in Decatur, Lord. Continue to build your kingdom, that more might come to know who you are, Lord, and the truth of your great love for them. Lord, use us in mighty ways to share that love with others, that they might ask what it is that is that hope, that joy, that love that flows out of us. What is that source, Lord? And that you may open their hearts and their minds to hear and to believe, Lord, to come to you, that you would draw more and more people to yourself. And we thank you for the blessing of you including us in that, Lord. All these things we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his loving favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Once again, thanks for being here in worship with us. It was a blessing to be gathered with you. A couple things before you go. First, I invite you to go check out our Guatemala table that's out there and see how you might be able to be a part of what we're doing there. And also, second, I heard that our LSA boys basketball team, for the first time, is conference champions. And so we extend a congratulations to them and a praise God there as well. So with that being said, go in peace and serve the Lord.